Thank again Tacoma Station. Tacoma Station donated this venue to us so that we can open this up for free. And I want to also say a major, major thank you. Thank you so much to Open Gate International. I just thank you guys so much for those who were able to help me put this together so that these wonderful survivor leaders can share their voice exactly how they want to share their voice. Share their voice. I mean, this isn't scripted. They can say whatever they want when they get on here. This is open mic for survivor leader time. Amen. So for a quick second, I know we're running a little bit behind. I'm going to change segments really quickly. We're going to go into the poetry and musical section. It's going to be very quickly, but we're going to also have this amazing, amazing solo. But while he's setting up, I want to talk about the reality. See, what this first half was logistics. We're going to call this logistics. This is how you learn the truth from our stories, from people who are up speaking, going to the White House, lobbying in front of your politicians, right? Going to senators, changing legislation. That's these voices right here, right in front of you. These are world changers. You know how hard it was to have a diplomat prosecuted in America? Do you know how difficult that was? That's an amazing miracle of Jesus Christ. You almost forgot that part. We prayed together about that thing. Yes, we did. We held hands and we claimed in the name of Jesus that it would be possible for her to receive justice. Yes, yes.
Yes, we did pray together. By the way, it took me more than 9 years to prosecute my case because it was hard because of him. I remember meeting the lawyer. It doesn't matter what kind of person I met. I met Swagas from accountability. A girl accountability. Every time when they ask me, when they say, oh, diplomat, immunity, I can remember their face, their expression. But guess what? I forgot to remember something. Yes, I'm making change. On a federal level, because change, I can see the changes. I'm making change. Like last month, I spoke some of you. I know I have some fans who was like, I was speaking at DC, human trafficking task force, like, Department of State Prosecutors, he told me, like, finance, after hearing your story, and thank you for standing up, I can't believe what you went through. You stand up like this, but because of you, I have 12 cases. Labor trafficking, and it's prosecuted. But because of you, I'm gonna take labor trafficking seriously, and I wanted the community to work with me. I'm gonna take, traffickers accountable. So, I spoke with lawyers, I trained lawyers, I trained like health cares. I did last month, I filed a dossier in front of judges. They are making changes. They change the way they do things. So I'm glad I'm not just losing my voice, but not like listening, but people are taking action. So I love what I do. Yes, this woman here learned English from cartoon, but guess what? That doesn't define me. I'm here for change, making change. Thank you. This is what freedom looks like.
Can you imagine silence? So you know what? When she won the mic, she had a mic.
Amen.
You've been silent for 10 years and you had to win a court case to talk out loud about your story. She can keep a mic in her purse as far as I'm concerned. Okay. All right, I'm just gonna, I just wanna just first, oh my God, let me just tell you guys something. And I just wanna give a shout out real quick to my boy, Paul, I see back there with my cousin. Oh my God, I love you so much. He plays the other guy, and he plays the trafficker in Seven Layers Captive. And his story and my story is so powerful. We had and I have to just tell it real quick because we're about to transition into the arts side. Are y'all ready for that? Y'all ready for some poems, some letters, some music? Great. Let me tell you about Paul really quickly about our story. He was a last minute person. I was doing this Seven Layers Captive at the Kennedy Center. And my other cousin was unable to actually fill the role of my trafficker. And a friend of mine said, I have, you know, the perfect person, because I just said, you know, I always say he needs to be this big and that size. And he sent me a picture and I dropped the phone. And I became so literally stuck and afraid and like complete fear took over me because I've never seen someone look so much exactly like my trafficker. Wow. And the Lord showed me then that I was not healed after 15 years. And that he was determined to deliver me before the Kennedy Center. So when he brought Paul, which he had to be named Paul because that's my father's name, the only man in my life that I have not been wanting to totally kill if he looked like my trafficker, that word, that name Paul was what actually enabled me to actually go make it through those rehearsals. And my sister over here will tell you about it because when he walked in and we were about to practice, she almost had a heart attack too. Because mind you, my trafficker was her trafficker. So it's good to see you. And now we're gonna transition. And I just wanna say, look, Tacoma Station was one of the first places. It was the very first place that I ever did poetry after getting out and escaping the game. There was a band called the Rickish Mojo, and Joe Claire was their front person. Is that what it's called, the front person? I don't know. Anyway, Joe Claire was the front person, and Ricky Payton Jr. back here, an amazing, amazing musician. Their whole team changed my whole life. They were the first men that I encountered after the game the same day that I left the life that did not look at me as a hoe, that did not sexually objectify me, that respected me, and most importantly, they called me Stacy, my real name, a name that I hadn't heard for 2 years. And when they used to come up here and play and do the band, and they made me their little reception, and I was the receptionist, and I was terrible at it. I didn't answer phones, but I didn't type up anything. I was the worst. I was the worst. They knew I was the worst, but they were like, hey, you gonna figure it out. I didn't figure it out because suddenly I didn't want to because I came into Tacoma Station where they were playing one day. Right here they were playing, and I was their production assistant during show night. So all I did was get water, and I used to be psyched about it. Be going back there to the bar, like, hey, all right, they need water. And I would just be going back and forth between this bar and this stage in Tacoma Station. And they would get up here and do poetry, and they would get up here and sing, and they would get up here and do all of these different things. And I remember shyly going to them and being like, hey, Rick, this guy, the leader of the band, 16 years ago, I just remember going, hey, Rick, I know I get the water and I answer the phones, but I can do poetry. Look, I was watching you guys, what you do, and I wrote my very first poem about the game in their office. And I said, do you think I can get on this stage? Look, I'll read it for you. And this guy back here said, don't read me nothing. I'll see you on the stage when we hit it. And he let me come up here and do my first poem. So I'm gonna let's have a musical transition really quickly, and we're gonna get ready. And a tribute.